What is up, Wisconsin and beyond? Welcome if you are just joining us. My name is Maggie Dawn, host of The Maggie Dawn Show, and it is 3 p.m. That means it is time for Maggie and the Millionaires Talking Money. Today, we're talking about the rigged economy, one of those things that we talk about quite a lot in the 3 o'clock hour because it's quite rigged. What we're going to talk about today are capital gains taxes. You've heard from both myself and many guests that we should be taxing wealth just like we tax work. And one of those types of wealth that we're going to talk about today are capital gains. Here's why this is incredibly timely. Last week, Vice President Harris called for a substantial increase in the capital gains tax for anyone that already makes $1 million or more every year. But she declined to endorse and stand behind a proposal that the Biden administration has made to equalize cap gains and ordinary income tax rates for the richest Americans. Again, she's called to only raise the capital gains tax rate from 20% to 28%, not to equalize them for everybody that makes more than $1 million. My guests are Erica Payne, founder and director, president of the Patriotic Millionaires, and one of those millionaires we talk about, Morris Pearl. He used to work for BlackRock, the largest investment firm in the world. He is the chair of Patriotic Millionaires. Erica, Morris, welcome back to the show. Certainly happy to have you.
So happy to be here.
Great to be on, Maggie.
Let's start with the basics, Morris. What's the difference between capital gains and income, and why are there different tax rates?
Look, there's different ways of making money. Most people get a paycheck every week or every month, and there's tax deduct from that paycheck. Some people, those like me, who are already rich, don't have to work. Since we're already rich, we don't need to. I can just sit here and watch the numbers on my screen as the prices of the stock goes up. And then I see myself making money, and only if I sell some stock do I actually pay tax on the amount of profit I made on that particular stock. And even then, it's at a much lower rate. We have preferential capital gains rates. So my tax brackets that I pay are zero for up into low six figures, 15% on most of the money I make, and maybe 20% if I make more than a certain amount. Much lower than what you pay on the paycheck that you earn.
So capital gains tax, just to be clear, is not like income tax, which if you work for a living, you get a paycheck, you are paying income tax, you cannot avoid it. That is, you know, the two things you can count on in life, death and taxes. Well, that's not actually true, right? It's death and taxes if you get a paycheck. Capital gains taxes, Morris, you're saying, again, only apply when you basically invest money and make a profit from that money and realize that gain. Morris, Erica, can either of you give us some idea why has there been this historical preferential treatment for capital gains? Why is that wealth increase not taxed just like work?
Now, do you want the cynical answer or the non-cynical answer?
Both, but start with the cynical one, Erica.
I mean, I'll start. Well, first of all, so capital gains rates and ordinary income tax rates have gone up and down throughout history. Sometimes they're more equal than other times. The question anytime you're trying to set a tax rate is, I should one kind of money be taxed differently than another? Are you going to affect something positively or negatively if you tax something in one way or another? So the way that the current tax system is set up, the people who design the tax system think that money should be taxed differently depending on how you make it. So it's a lot of tax on ordinary income, less tax on capital gains income, and basically no tax on inheritance income the way the current system is set up. We believe, as the Patriotic Millionaires, that these differences don't make a lot of sense, and that the reasoning behind the differences is really based on flawed logic. So as we go into the 2025 big battle we're going to have around taxes, so we've talked about this a few times on your show, Maggie, Trump and the Republicans put in a tax system in 2017 on a party line vote. I just want to remind everybody that in 2018, for the first time in American history, billionaires paid a lower effective tax rate than every single other group of people in the country. Well, a bunch of those tax provisions are going to expire in 2025. So whoever's in charge is going to be in charge of deciding what to do with these taxes. And the people in charge can either decide to keep the differential between all the different kinds of money, so we can keep on saying that in America, the home of the free, land of the brave, we think it is most important that people who inherit income don't pay any taxes, that we think that capital, you know, people investing their money, that they should pay lower taxes than people who work. The patriotic millionaires think that at a certain point, money is money is money is money is money is money is money. And so when you make more than $1 million a year, we don't think anybody needs to get any preferential anything for anybody. And so if we want to set the top marginal income tax rate at 39.6%, which would revert it to the numbers it was pre-Trump, we think all money should be taxed exactly the same, regardless of how you make it. Matt, yep, we give you just a simple dollar figure. Some of the targets. We have a 15-minute PowerPoint presentation on taxtherich.com. It'll tell you everything you need to know about America's tax system. 15 minutes, it's fun, engaging. I would love for people to go watch it. On that, we compare two couples, the work hearts and the slumps, and what happens to their tax bill as they go through life making the same amount of money in different ways. So the work hearts go to work, work hard. They work 50 weeks a year, 40 hours a week. They bring home $100,000. They'll pay about $9,000 in federal taxes on that $100,000. If a billionaire is sitting in his beach property, drinking a Mai Tai, and clicks a button on an E-Trade account, selling some stock, and he makes $100,000, Maggie, guess how much money that billionaire will pay on that $100,000 of income that he made?
I'm going to say nothing unless he sells it.
Well, no. So he sold it. So he made his $100,000. On that first $100,000, he is going to pay $0. So here's a couple working all year, every day. They end the year $9,000 poorer than the rich person who clicks a button on an E-Trade account. So we think that that's just crazy. You know, but the people who wrote the tax bill, and more importantly, the people who give money to the people who wrote the tax bill when they run for campaigns, those rich people who largely make their money off of capital gains felt very, very, very strongly that their money was more important than your sweat, Maggie. And so they want a tax break for their money. And they say that you got to have this tax break for capital investment or everybody's going to stop investing and the whole world's going to collapse.
Yeah, that's the interesting part to me, Erica. One thing, you know, we haven't seen many CEOs come out explicitly in favor of the Trump tax cuts or this sort of a tax system. In fact, they have been notably silent, some of them actually opposing it. Now, you do have some billionaires that have voiced support for candidates, which I think is really fascinating. And to me, it tips a hat to this idea about investment and building businesses and continuing to spur economic growth. What's going on here, Morris? I mean, again, the traditional argument we hear is, oh my gosh, if you raise taxes on rich people and corporations, business will come to some sort of screeching halt and people will stop investing. Is that true?
Well, no. If you think about economics, it's a totality that the total amount of savings is equal to the total amount of investment. I have, you know, millions of dollars my family and I have saved up over the years. And unless I like take it in cash and like move to Mars or something, it exists. It will exist regardless of whether you change the tax laws or not. And I could invest in the stock market, or I could invest in something else. I could put in the bank, and the bank can then use the money to make loans to people. But that money will exist someplace, somewhere. And it's not like I can like go on strike and say, oh, I'm not going to be a millionaire anymore until you change my tax rates. It's like there's nothing I can do about it. So mean, it's like complete hogwash.
It's like, where did this, if I can ask Morris, this has been part of sort of conservative dogma. I would also even argue you've kind of gotten this whiff of things for a while from some economists. And the argument, as I understood it, always went something like this. Well, all else being equal, if you tax money more, there's less of incentive to earn it. To which I always responded, huh? Like, people, if the line of logic is people are in a wealth building mindset, if we're profit maximizing, unless the tax rate was 100% on your first dollar, it doesn't make any sense to me. Again, I don't understand the incentive argument. Is that basically what we're talking about here? That people will participate in the economy because that's how you make money.
I agree. I mean, I've met some of those people walking around your studio in Chicago a couple weeks ago. It's ridiculous because plenty of people I know who are billionaires, they were highly incentivized to earn their first billion. They don't need special incentive to not pay taxes on their second billion. And it's like, even if they're not incentivized at all, unless their tax rate is 100%, they'd rather get part of a profit and give part to the government to make no profit at all.
Yeah.
Well, and Maggie, this is one of the things, I mean, this is a mythology that is so sticky in the American psyche and in the psyche of our candidates. And I mean, you know, God bless them and the psyches of all of these investors who are absolutely certain they need that incentive. I guess the main thing that we would like to ask them is, if you believe that you need a lower tax rate in order to invest, and say that we raised your tax rate, what are you going to do with your money? What are they going to do with their money? And is they don't have a lot of options. They can leave it in a savings account and make like point something nothing, you know, or they can invest it and make something. And so the choice is to not invest it and make nothing, or to invest it and make something. And, you know, more
they're going to make something. My special guest this half hour for Maggie, Talking Money with the Millionaires, are Morris Pearl and Erica Payne. Keep it locked. We're going to dig in more after these brief messages here on the Civic Media Radio Network.
Our economy's on fire.
What's up, Wisconsin? Welcome back, or welcome if you're just joining us. My name is Maggie Dawn, host of the Maggie Dawn Show here on the Civic Media Radio Network. Joined this half hour for today's 3 p.m. edition of Maggie and the Millionaires Talking Money are Erica Payne, an economic justice advocate and the founder and president of Patriotic Millionaires. She's a pretty smart lady, got an MBA from the Wharton School at UPenn. And Morris Pearl, a former managing director at BlackRock, the largest investment firm in the world, and the chair of the Patriotic Millionaires. Morris, why do the Patriotic Millionaires want the capital gains rate and the income tax rate to be equalized for people that make more than $1 million a year?
Because part of the reason why we have such inequality in our country, part of the reason why we have a few people getting richer and richer and richer, while so many millions are struggling to get by, is that those of us who are already rich pay lower tax rates than people that are working for a living. And honestly, this won't even solve the problem, but it would make a dent if people pay the same tax rates on money they got from their investments that other people pay from their working. But somehow the rich people have convinced the politicians that, oh, we need to appease rich people. We can't like upset them or anything, or they'll, I don't know what.
And this is a huge problem. I mean, let's as we sit here today, the United States is more unequal than it has been in 100 years. And we have set a tax code that guarantees we are going to become more unequal more quickly over time. Our country is about to fall apart with income inequality and economic inequality at the levels it is now. let's go on and wait a few more years and make it worse and see how bad this is. We're basically playing a game of economic Jenga where we're pulling off of the bottom, pulling off of the middle, loading it on the top. And the societal cost of this is really obvious when you look around and see that some people are flying off into space in their rocket ships, and some people can barely live, you know, can't even live in their cars because they don't own a car. And so a society this unequal cannot stand. Mathematically, if every dollar that Morris makes is worth more, valued more, ends up in more revenue into his pocket than every dollar that somebody else makes working, then mathematically we can't go direction other than more unequal more quickly over time. And we're going to have an even bigger problem than we have right now. So what we're trying to eliminate is one of the key drivers of inequality in this country. Why? Is there a good reason for Morris's money to be worth someone else's sweat? There isn't. There's not an investment reason for it. As we talked about in the last segment, what are people going to do? They're going to invest regardless of the tax rate. Again, most people make investment decisions because they want to make big, big money, not because they want to shave a few points on a tax rate. That's number one. The second justification that investors give is that they're taking a lot of risk. They're saying, well, I'm risking my money. I'm risking my money by making this investment. First of all, if you're making more than $1 million a year, I don't think you're risking all that much. So let's say that you're only doing income over $1 million. But the other thing is there are lots of ordinary jobs that have a huge amount of risk involved in them. Look at a firefighter. A firefighter risks his life or her life every single time they walk into a burning building. Fire people, depending on where they make it, may make up to $100,000 a year. You really think that somebody who runs into a burning building should pay higher taxes than somebody sitting on a leather armchair behind their desk on Wall Street and, again, clicking a button on an E-Trade account? There are risks and there are risks, and the risks of the investor do not supersede the risk of somebody walking into a flaming building. So why on earth are they getting a preferential tax rate? So when you examine it, the evidence falls away, the investment case, the risk case. I'll tell you something else. American University just came out with a new report saying that if we raise the capital gains rate, we would increase the amount of revenues coming into the United States and GDP would actually go up.
We have historical precedent for this, right? And I would even say, just on your risk point, Erica, I couldn't agree with you more. And this, when you are rich enough, i.e. making already $1 million a year, and we're talking about taxing your investment returns, right, your capital gains, I don't know that the, quote, risk that you're taking is as real as the risk that accrues to the vast majority of regular Americans who are at-will employees whose entire family's economic health hinges on whether or not they get to keep a job on a day-over-day basis. I don't know a lot of people with job protections anymore. They can walk into work and get fired the next day. That isn't monopoly money to them. That is the money that their families need to live on. I would say if there's a preference to be given, if we're going to pick winners and bigger winners, that the biggest winners should be those that take that economic risk, are in at-will employment situations that need that money to support their families, not over-rewarding investment risk that is a calculated risk taken by people that can afford to invest their money. Now, you mentioned, Erica, that when we tax rich folks more, when we equalize or try to raise capital gains taxes, that our GDP actually goes up. We have some historical precedent for this, don't we?
You want to talk about people who take risks with their income? How about the woman who handed me eggplant parm hero for lunch today at a deli?
Yeah.
She has a lot more uncertainty in her income than I do, I assure you.
Well, and investors, if they lose money, they can write it off from gains that they made before. So there are lots of ways for wealthy people to balance their so-called risk. I would just assert the premise that it ain't all that risky in the first place. And while they might be spending their money, working people are spending their time and their sweat and their energy. So everybody's got what they've got on the line. And people who are spending their time, sweat, and energy are being taxed at almost twice the tax rate that people who are making money off of their money are making. It's a driver of inequality. There is no rational justification for it. And we're you know, we think that unfortunately some folks have gotten to Vice President Harris on her economic team. And so she has walked back Biden's proposal to equalize incomes. Now she's still asking for a pretty hefty raise, which we think is quite important, but she doesn't get as far as we want her to get. And so we would just love to see people really encourage that. I also want to tell you, you know, in terms of these investment folks just making up stuff. So there's a little loophole that has to do with this. So people who manage other people's money even get to pay that smaller preferential tax rate. It's this little loophole called the carried interest loophole. And your senator in Wisconsin, Tammy Baldwin, has been an absolutely fantastic advocate on getting rid of that preference for folks who manage other people's money. So there's some preference, you know, you've got a leader in the Senate. We're seeing a good leadership from Vice President Harris. We want to see her lean into it even more and go all the way to equalizing it. Now,
equalizing capital gains tax rates with income tax rates, because work is just as valuable. The dollars produced from work is just as valuable as a dollar produced from doing nothing and investing it. Folks, you can find out more about this at taxtherich.com. Check it out, because it's always and ever about the money, money, money. Thanks to Erica Payne, founder of the Patriotic Millionaires, as well as Morris Pearl, the chair of the Patriotic Millionaires. I'm Maggie Dawn. We'll be back in just a moment after your farm update with the Maggie Dawn Show here on the Civic Media Radio Network.
Probably wouldn't be here if it weren't for the American worker.